Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome once again to the ESL Pro Series Season 11. I am Pyrotechnics. I'm joined by TJ Azumo Cutie. Sanders, I gave your full name this time, too.
Thank you. I appreciate that. We got lots of League of Legends action coming to you guys today. The conclusion of the ESL Pro Series Season 11 semifinals and on, so I'm excited.
I am extremely excited, man. There have been some amazing plays that we just saw yesterday on a big old marathon, but of course there's going to be even more exciting action coming up today. I can feel it. We got four teams remaining, and we'll take a look on the screen right now how this tournament's gone so far, how it's going to go. Eight open bracket teams faced off against eight invite teams. We've now broken that down to four. Each quarterfinalist team, all the teams you saw yesterday, take home $1,000 at least, but they've all doubled their prize money if they stuck around, and they'll do it again if they can win today.
Yeah, everything's been best of three up until the finals. So the semifinals will be broadcast first, will be best of three. Finals, of course, will be best of five, and it's for a $20,000 prize pool, so $8,000 to first place, $4,000 to second. That's a lot of money for these guys going into the Challenger Series coming up in a few weeks.
Absolutely. It's definitely a good proving ground. They're going to be able to test out what they want. You know, a lot of the teams were talking about how they wanted to improve their equipment, too, so they want to make sure they can take home some money and grab a little bit of extra hardware, better hardware, to be able to compete in the Challenger Series.
So. For sure.
Some of them are hoping they can get going. But again, four teams remaining. We'll take a look at the bracket in just a sec to see who's still standing and who just might take home that $8,000 top prize. MSI, TDK, Team Dragon Knights, you might call them, are going to face off against Team 321 for one of those semifinal spots.
Yeah, and then coming up the second part of the day, it's going to be Team Fusion taking on Monster Kittens, who had, I guess you could call it an upset victory against Enemy Esports, who had a little bit of hype surrounding their new roster. So it was definitely a really great match that we saw yesterday. Akkadian bringing out some crazy picks up in the top lane, the Rengar, the top lane, the Yasuo.
Oh, yeah.
So some great, great matches today.
Yeah, I'm pretty excited to see how that one shakes out. Enemy Esports, yeah, they had a lot of hype. They weren't able to quite live up to it. Honestly, a lot of the teams that we expected to do quite well look shaky. Team Fusion barely pulling out a win, but we'll have to talk about all that stuff a little bit later. Right now, into picks and bans, TDK, 3-2-1. NAR taken off the board right away. No surprises there.
Yeah, that's definitely been a pretty targeted ban at a lot of these top laners here. And there's actually been mostly top lane bans throughout the competitive play over the past couple weeks. Because there's a lot of flex picks right now. There's not too much of a defined meta in top lane. Picks like Kassadin, Lissandra, Jace, Azir.
Especially if Narakile is playing on the enemy team.
Yeah, that's a big deal. And I can expect that the Jace ban is going to come out. Kyle or Narakile, he was a popular Jace streamer, only Jace player from Korea. So that champion is just out of this world good for Kyle. So I can imagine we're going to see it banned out. We saw played it once yesterday in the quarterfinals, and he destroyed, I believe it was Yusui, who was considered to be one of the best Challenger mid laners in North America. So it was really impressive. No Jace ban.
Well, there is at the top there. Azir.
Oh,
as well.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Sorry. I thought that was a...
It's okay. It happens to me too.
Yeah.
The Thresh
I just saw
and Pantheon,
the Rek'Sai and I was like, yeah. Oh, geez.
Oh, yeah. They're not doing it. No, TDK all around. You mentioned how Narakile looked really impressive, but they really were the most convincing win of yesterday. The only 2-0. Everybody else had a kind of a climb
really
back in.
Really long and grueling
Very
series.
Long sets. Yeah, and this was TDK kind of made short work of their opponents. And that was also, that was Cloud9's new Challenger roster that they were able to beat. So really, really impressive play from them. Seraph seems to have found a really good place. He performed much better yesterday than I think I've ever seen him do on CLG. Mm-hmm. And you know, there we go. They've locked in the Lissandra. I think that's a pretty good choice. Also a flex pick. But Seraph has been rocking and rolling on a lot of these more carry-based champions as well.
Definitely. And one thing you got to point out here is Aurelia was actually left on the table, which is one of Big Ol' Ron's best champions by far. A lot of times he gets targeted, banned Aurelia at them. When you're playing 3-2-1, you always have to think in the back of your head, Aurelia and Fiddlesticks, because Big Ol' Ron and Azingian, those two champions, are just spectacular. And we saw Azingian play Fiddlesticks once yesterday, and it actually wasn't that fantastic. They still ended up winning, but still, it's always something that you have to keep in the back of your head, because if there's anybody that's going to bring out a fantastic jungle Fiddlesticks, it's going to be Azingian.
Yeah, and it hasn't been banned away from him as well. I believe they didn't really spend too many bans against him yesterday. It was fairly instrumental in their win, but he was able to come and make a big play on Jarvan, for example. That's been taken away now by TDK. Also, the Annie lock-in We haven't seen Annie too much in competitive lately. There has been a couple of places, I believe, it was played, I want to say top in either China or Korea recently. I can't recall exactly, but you know, it makes for an interesting strategy and an interesting counterplay potential. Annie's a very, very difficult to play against champion if you want to get up in the enemy's face.
Yeah, and Annie is also a flex pick as well because you can put her in mid lane, you can put her at support. I can imagine with their picks right now that it is going to be a support, but we'll have to see. And right away, they hover over the Aurelia and the Fiddlesticks. This is going to be really dangerous. They're beyond comfort picks, and this lineup in general for 3-2-1 is just all comfort picks up and down. Indivisible, by far, is most played support in Ami. Jackstar, he's a Graves, Corki type player. And then I talked about a little bit earlier, Aurelia and Fiddlesticks for Big Ol' Ron and Azingi respectively is just devastating combination. So we'll have to see what TDK has planned for this, because they have to imagine and have done their scouting, especially since a lot of these players have played against Big Ol' Ron and Azingi for quite some time. Kez, he's been around North America for a long time. So see what they round off the lineup with.
I think LuiGG might go for the Graves or Lucian. That seems to be the more likely calling card for him. I'm curious about where the Lulu would go, though, if they do lock that in. That's an interesting choice, and that might indicate a mid Annie. Or even, we've seen a top Annie as well, I believe, recently. That was the one I was mentioning.
I would imagine if they did pick that up, it would go top lane, and we'd see a mid Lissandra.
Okay, Nezra Lincoln. Okay. Yeah. I mean, but you mentioned, though, 3-2-1 really didn't have too much ban specifically against them, and it's kind of terrifying. They get the cast in lock in as well for Arc second, and a lot of comfort picks really given over to the side. And this is, I don't know if this is TDK being, you know, very confident saying, we can let them have that. We're just going to ban the things that we're worried about specifically, or they just aren't really setting up on it.
Yeah, these are scary team comps for both sides, but I think 3-2-1 is probably a little bit happier about the pick and ban phase, just because this is almost the exact team comp that 3-2-1 has been practicing in the rank fives ladder, but the comp that they usually try and go for. You go even back as far as Fission when they competed in the expansion tournament with Azingi and Indivisible being the two players that still remain. This looks really similar to a composition that they would have even run back then. So maybe with the exception of Kassadin, but still comfort picks across the board. Now TDK has some picks that we haven't seen very much lately. Kyle is going to be playing mid lane Lulu. And Konkwan's going to be playing the support Annie. So it's a little bit different picks, but TDK overall seems to be a little bit unique with their picks and with their playstyle. So it looks like, had a little bit of a pause there, but we are back in action. So I'm really excited to get going with this series, because 3-2-1 was sort of the team that flew under the radar coming into this tournament, where TDK was a team that not many people knew about. There was a little bit of hype surrounding their roster because they have some big names and some players from Korea. And yesterday, they just impressed me more than any other team. So I'm curious to see who's gonna be coming out on top of this matchup.
Yeah, it's definitely an interesting set for sure, just because of the histories of the teams and TDK rocking this new roster. They have Seraph, now known as Kena, and Nara Kyle, who is shown some pretty big heart on a lot of champions that, you know, aren't necessarily Jace, but when he's been given it, they've been rocking and rolling. This time they have a little bit of a different champion selection, and I'm interested to see how deep those pools do go. On the other side, 3-2-1 is sticking to what they know. Azingi on that Fiddlesticks right there, and this is a champion. He says he doesn't even have to practice. He just knows it.
Yeah, well, Azingi has some of the most games played out of any solo queue player in like Masters Challenger. So he plays Fiddlesticks a lot in solo queue whenever it's not banned. So at some point, it just all becomes muscle memory and you don't even need to practice it anymore. Of course, you need to try and fit it into your team strategies, but I was talking to him and he said, even if sometimes we have the opportunity to play it in like scrims or in ranked five, sometimes we won't just so we can practice other things. Because a lot of the times it does get banned out against him. And especially now that Fiddlesticks is even stronger than he was before, because of how sustained junglers have sort of gotten a little bit of buff because of the difficulty of the jungle. It's even better of a pick for him, I think.
Yeah, I definitely agree. It's been kind of a buff up to him and a boon to 3-2-1 as a team so far, but the way they're starting this game off, nice and simple. They don't want to get really hyphy just to begin it. Neither of these teams really indicated that in their set earlier. They were a little bit more conservative in the very early lane phase. 3-2-1's really like that, with the exception of Azingi trying to make plays, especially on the bottom and in the middle. This time he probably will go back to that bottom side, because Konquan and LuiGG are on two champions that can get fairly scary if they get rolling.
Yeah, a big thing to watch here is Kez. We actually haven't seen him on Jarvan in a long time. I was scouting their rank 5s a little bit, and he played it some, but a lot of times he seems to go more towards Elise and Lee Sin if they're available. So I'm curious to see how he's going to fare on Jarvan, who Kez plays a very control style of jungle. He likes to get vision. He plays a supportive role for his lanes a lot of the time and not very gank heavy. He rushes Sightstone first on a lot of junglers, and he focuses heavily on map control and counter jungling. And you can see right here that that's exactly what he's doing. A lot of times he focuses very heavily on mid lane, making sure his mid lane is safe. And he does that by just applying pressure to the map with wards and with counter jungle like he's doing right now. Fiddlesticks is a jungler who is susceptible to being counter jungled a little bit, because if you interrupt his drain, his clear time is slow,
but
and he's caught in the jungle.
Also just a little bit squishy, as you saw there. They've taken fairly low. Konquan, though, bubbled up in the bottom side. Jackstar Exhaust is on him, and all of a sudden they just want to start racking up some fights. Konquan sticking around, staying alive, but now Kez and Kina are attempting to steal away this red buff. Should be able to get it smited down by Kez.
So 3-2-1, one of their biggest strengths as a team is getting leads early. In every single match that they played yesterday, they had an early lead. The trouble that they have is turning that early lead into an advantage in the mid and the late game. They seem very indecisive with their shot calls, and sometimes it takes them a long time to close out games, even when they're far ahead. So the one thing that they have to improve on, and I'm looking for them to do today, is to really just turn an early lead into a big advantage. And right now you can already see, just in the laning phase alone, they're already about 300, 400 gold ahead. And so that just seems to be a trend with these guys. Now TDK, on the other hand, they seem to have a little bit of a slower start, a little bit of a slower early game. But yesterday they just ramped up so hard in mid game, and they were the team, like we said, they had the only 2-0, they had the most decisive victories out of any other team, and they were facing a pretty strong team in Cloud9 G2A, or the Cloud9 B team, as a lot of people like to call it.
Yeah, I really, you can account for the fact that maybe they don't have the synergy built up yet, or the experience built up yet, but all the same, taking out a team with that many stars, that many good players, well-known challenger players, is a pretty big deal. And TDK are showing up and saying the mean business here now. LuiXGG is going to get caught just for a moment. A little bit of burst there. Azingi waiting in the bottom brush, as he is wont to.
The praying mantis.
Yes. Waits for the right moment to strike. And as you mentioned yesterday, Fiddlesticks does kind of look like a really scary praying mantis.
Azingi has a lot of nicknames.
He does.
The Master Tactician. The Praying Mantis. What else? What else do I want to call?
Fiddlesticks.
Just Fiddlesticks.
He is Fiddlesticks.
Yeah. But he, Azingi, you'll notice he really likes bot lane. If you think back to the expansion tournament, which is sort of the last exposure Azingi got, in some of those games, in both the games that they played, he played Jarvan, and he camped bot lane just so hard. Whoa, Jackstar!
Ooh, boy! And oh, there's Azingi waiting for the time to strike. Jackstar wanting to go in for round two. LuiGG, though, a little far forward. They don't have a stun available. There we go. Smite it down. Has to burn his flash away. Indivisible, though, is a little bit low, and they'll back off that fight. Really weird gank attempt by Kez, though. He kind of just ran through the brush when he knew the ward was down, and just kind of walked into lane.
Yeah, I mean, he was just trying to give his bottom lane a little bit more room to breathe, which is what he needed to do, because they were starting to fall behind. You could tell 10 CS behind. They had to back. This wave's going to hit their turret a little bit. So, I mean, a big part of getting an early lead in games is a lot of time focused around bot lane, which is one of the reasons why I think 3-2-1 does it, because this thing, he focuses so heavy on that bot lane. Being ahead in bot lane, if you get kills down there, you're forcing two players off the map, and you're also taking better control of the bottom side, which is usually what leads to getting early leads, because of dragon control, and because more of players are weighted towards the bottom side of the map, then more of the gold generally would be weighted towards the bottom side of the map.
Yeah, TDK and 3-2-1 aren't really teams that like to do the lane swap from what we've seen so far either. They tend to try to play out a more conventional laning phase because that's just what is way more familiar to do. All these other lanes, as a result, have been a little bit more quiet. Even after 6, Kyle and Arc Second are just kind of hanging out, giving each other a little bit of a respect game, a little poke back and forth. Dead even in farm on that one. 3-1 does have that slight lead from before, as you mentioned. It's fairly inconsequential until a big play does happen, but you can see both sides are just testing the waters to see if they can grab themselves a quick first blood.
Yeah, lane swaps, they happen all the time. They've been happening all the time in Korea, and OGNs are, or LIC, League champions.
Never gonna get
League
me to
Legends
say that.
Champions Korea.
There you go.
But the only lane swap we saw yesterday was initiated by Fusion in one of their matches, and it was executed poorly. And it actually was, they got so far behind early that it was actually a big reason why they lost.
Oh boy, there was a good stun that might have resulted in a pick up, but it's going to anyways. Crow bounce, although it is picked up by Jackstar. First blood to 3-2-1.
And the Zingy, he pitched his tent. Pitched his tent in the bot lane.
He's always camping, man.
Yeah, he really is. And now he's already level 6. Kez has not hit level 6 yet. Kez, like I said, he likes to focus around that mid lane. He's a control-style jungler that heavily focuses around vision around mid lane and around Dragon.
Oh, speaking of Dragon.
But 3-2-1 have a style that sort of counters that because they usually play safe in the mid lane. Arc Second, he plays a lot of those like control-style mages. I mean, he did play Zed a couple times yesterday, but he usually plays champions that can hold their own without help from Zingy. And Big Ol' Ron as well, he's one of the strongest laners, I think, because of how highly rated he is in the North American solo queue ladder right now, that Zingy can afford to focus on bottom side of the map and not worry about his solo laners being in any trouble.
Yeah, Big Ol' Ron's actually done quite well for himself so far, kept about pace with Seraph, who hasn't really done any more than just farm it up too. I think they're both trying to play it safe to where they hit a decent power spike. Now here, TDK though is going for this red steal again, and they know that Zingy doesn't really hang around on the top side of his jungle more than he can avoid, so it's almost like they can just grab it for free.
Well, this is sort of a necessary thing for them. They can't give up a kill on the bottom side of the map and a dragon and not take anything for themselves. They can't sit back and be complacent with that type of move from 3-2-1. So I would definitely expect a roam attempt here to try and make a little bit of impact on mid lane. You want to take as much as you can on the top side of the map, and here we go, Arc Second, Frozen Tomb.
Yep. Kena, Seraph going in on that one. They should find Arc Second, but Kena was way too low in that, even with the Wild Growth. And now Kez has picked off a double kill for Big Ol' Ron off of his teleport, and he's looking for a triple. Forces the flash out of Kyle, and Big Ol' Ron just steamrolls down that mid lane.
And that's not good for TDK. I said they needed to make something happen on that opposite side of the map from the Dragon, getting behind in the bottom lane, but Big Ol' Ron with the well-placed teleport there. And even though they really wanted something to happen in the mid lane, they went a little too far for it. They used a lot of resources to try and take out Arc Second. It took a while to take him down. Even though they did pick up the kill, giving Big Ol' Ron a double kill at that point and using so many summoners to either escape or to pick up that kill on Arc Second is actually a pretty big deal.
Yeah, absolutely. And the fact that they kind of forced it, it seemed 3-2-1 kind of knew. And you always mention Zingy is that master tactician. He's absolutely that kind of guy, and he's very patiently waiting. He may not always be involved in the fights, but he definitely knows when something is going to happen, and he wants to make sure his team knows as well. Big Ol' Ron, very timely teleport, nets them a couple more kills, and they push down. Now, he's waiting in the wings down bottom once again. You can see TDK playing with a little bit of fear, not wanting to get anywhere near those brushes.
Yeah, Annie is a support that really not relies, but it is heavily focused on getting leads early on because she has so much damage potential in lane. And she does have great initiation power once she's level 6 with the Tipper stun.
Okay. They jump on Big Ol' Ron, and Seraph goes right on into him. The Frozen Tomb was almost enough, but Big Ol' Ron still gets the pickup onto Kez. And wait a minute, the outplay in 1v2. Big Ol' Ron coming up with his fourth kill of the game on top of it.
And that's a 2v1 situation, straight up, full health. All summoners plus both ultimates blown from the side of TDK, and Big Ol' Ron still comes out of top.
Speaking of ultimates blown,
as well,
though, yep, Conquan already evaporated. Jackstar looking for the chase as the tower is down. Zingy is still there. Indivisible was the one that got blown up, so both supports off the table, and Louis GG gets back to the safety of his second tier.
I just want to go back to that big old Ron play because he just hit a big power spike with that Trinity Force. Seraph's going to have a rough time in lane, and I mentioned it earlier, big ol' Ron, Aurelia is by far the champion that he has the most experience on. It's by far his best champion. If you think back to the expansion tournament, if you think back to like pre-expansion tournament when they were running with big ol' Ron, he couldn't play because he was underage, and if you look at their rank 5's history, like, they every single game, if you don't ban Aurelia, he picks it. That's just how it is. And he's just so comfortable on that champion that it makes it so hard for teams to be able to deal with it. And you can tell, I mean, he's 4-0 right now. And the big thing to worry about here is there's a huge mid power spike for 3-2-1 with two players being able to build an early Trinity Force. It takes a lot of ramp-up time for champions like Lulu and like Ezreal, because Ezreal went with that Mandamune build earlier. He's not going to be able to stand up to the damage potential of the Corki. They could be in a rough spot coming into this mid-game.
Absolutely. 3-2-1 are in a very good spot for themselves on the other side. And EDK's really questionable decision to allow so many comfort picks through seems to be burning them right now. Decent-sized gold lead for 3-2-1 in this 13.5-minute game. Mid lane's still a little bit quiet, but now it's right about to change. Narakal, realizing everybody's there, has to whimsy his way to safety. But Jakstar and Indivisible are interested in pushing this wave out. 1.5 minutes till the next dragon will spawn, and 3-2-1 controls that side of the map.
Oh yeah, they have so much control over that side of the map. And that's the style that they play. And you can tell, I said it earlier, they really just don't focus a lot on their solo lanes. And for good reason. When big ol' Ron, at 12 minutes into the game, can 2v1 the jungler and the enemy top laner, why do you need to even go up there as if you're a Zhengi in that situation?
Yeah, you don't need to bother at all.
It's just overkill.
Just absolutely trust. He's forcing Seraph to just back away the moment he's checking anywhere near him. And yeah, that Trinity Force is starting to really, really do some work for 3-2-1's top laner. ArcSecond's been holding his own in the mid. Yeah, he got taken out once, but they were able to grab two kills back for it. And it's starting to be a difficult-to-manage situation. 30 seconds on this dragon, and TDK, who have had spectacular dragon control in their previous two games in this tournament, are struggling to get in position to take this one.
They do have pretty good, like, ramp-up potential. They have good initiation power with the Tibbers from Annie, Frozen Tomb from Seraph, and like a Cataclysm. But at the same time, I talk about these power spikes, and you can't really say it enough. Like, the power around this mid game and around this second, third dragon for this 3-2-1 lineup is just so strong. The thing you gotta look for, though, is later in the game, if 3-2-1, once again, like we've said in the past, has trouble closing out a game, they will get outscaled, and it's going to be tough for them to find good initiations. Oh, here comes the teleport.
Yes, it does. Big ol' Ron wants to join the party. The dragon pretty low. Could get smited away by Kez. Actually getting feared up. The dragon is going to start resetting. Jakstar picks up the kill, and they should be able to secure this one. It's going to be Seraph taking out Indivisible, though. That dragon is smited down, but the fight is going a little bit haywire. 1-for-2 so far. Looking for more. They find Conquan. ArcSecond picking up the kill there. Blinking health bars all around, but 3-2-1. Get the dragon and get the fight.
Really great call, too, to pull off the dragon enough to not put it in smite range and then kill Kez before he has any potential. So that would have been a pretty good play if Kez had been able to get in there, steal it, and even take up his life for it. But just really great call by 3-2-1 to just hold damage. And they only trade 2-for-1, so it's not the best team fight for them, but they still come out on top and they pick up that second dragon. So they could pick up two dragons in this game very quickly. That's going to really help them ramp up and allow them to maybe close out the game quicker, which is something that this team, in like a playstyle sense, really needs. They need a lot of help closing out games.
Yeah, and if they can get up enough of a lead, that shouldn't be as much of a problem as we've seen it before. Again, 3-2-1 definitely had some rough games yesterday against Ground 6, but they are looking so much snappier right now. And a lot of that does come down to their fantastic pick ban phase that TDK just clearly wasn't ready for here. Taking out the tower in the middle, they'll be able to bail out. That's 2 towers to 0. Is the score line, and a decently sized lead is extended even further. About 5,500 gold in the lead, and that is pretty substantial for 17 minutes into the game.
We saw bigger leads yesterday, but
this is true.
You can tell that 3-2-1 is definitely in a place of comfort right now. They do have to worry about that initiation potential from TDK. does like a flash Tibbers or like a frozen tomb into a Tibbers is a pretty big deal.
Well, they might find something here. Jackstar is going to get shut down, and here comes Seraph. They want to pick off Indivisible Azingi, though. Crowstorm round the side, draining Louis GD, keeping him away from the team, but ArcSecond is in a little bit of trouble himself. They can't quite polish him off, but all the same, TDK will pick up two kills, and that's the initiation you were talking about.
That's not even a real initiation there. That's just Jackstar being caught way out of position and Indivisible being too far up to try and save him. That's just a really big positioning error by 3-2-1 and a great job by TDK to capitalize on it and just not to hesitate to pull the trigger. So
they really needed it, too.
That's going to be a little bit of breathing room for them, too. They were starting to fall really far behind. Picking up a couple kills is good, but they aren't able to get any objectives off that, so not the best. There is a lot of gold like invested into these towers. So 3-2-1, a large part of their goal lead is their three-turret advantage. So if TDK manages to win a fight or two and they start turning around these turrets, the gold lead could even up very, very quickly.
Yep. TDK.
Big ol' Ron waiting in the wings here. Or sorry, Azingi waiting in the wings here.
I think he's always waiting in the wings, man. TDK needs to be able to secure a little bit more of their own jungle, but they're giving this one up right now, and Azingi smites down the blue. They're not giving them any breathing room, despite being caught a couple times. Careful, Jackstar. A little bit far forward before, but still doing pretty solid right now. He's hit that Trinity Force power spike. Now they're looking to push down middle. There's an inner tower that they want to just melt through whenever they get the chance. Need a minion wave first, though.
Yep. So they don't have the best siege composition. They don't really have like any poke. They have really great wave clear, which is good in anti-siege, but they really need to find fights around this part. They need to utilize their power spike. But if TDK plays this intelligently and avoid fights unless they can find a pick or a really good engagement, it's going to be hard for 3-2-1 to actually like siege down these second tier turrets without risk of getting engaged on way into enemy territory.
Yep, now with TDK playing a little bit more cautiously, just not knowing exactly where the rest of 3-2-1 are. Big ol' Ron's kind of gone through and popped a deep ward down himself just to make sure that they can't catch them unawares. And he's kind of been off on his own ever since. And nobody from Team Dragonites is really trying to touch him here. They're just letting him have his way with that top lane.
That's not a great thing to do. Big ol' Ron's at 190 plus CS right now. He's got the highest CS in the game by almost 40 and 4 kills as well, which is also the highest. So I mean, he hit that Trinity Force super early, and he's already going towards his first defensive item. Once that happens, it's going to be hard for TDK to be able to deal with him in these teamfights until they ramp up. Lulu is a good mid laner, but she doesn't scale as well as far as her damage goes as other mid laners just because some of her scaling isn't damage. Some of her scaling is just the supportive. So they might be lacking damage later on to be able to kill Big Ol' Ron before he's able to take out some of their teammates. They do have a lot of mobility and a lot of... We saw when they ganked ArcSecond in the mid lane, even though he was Kassadin, who has absurd amounts of mobility, he still just got CC locked over and over again.
They do seem to be able to pounce on individual targets quite well, but they have a decent amount of AoE that they need to start utilizing. And 3-2-1 just have great positioning in their actual fights to not get caught in that cone of damage, but they do have to be careful to not get isolated too much. 15 seconds on this next dragon, and MSI really needs to stop this. They need to stop that third dragon from being picked off, but they're really not in position to do it. And actually, they're starting to move up by Baron. This is really curious. It's 21 and a half minutes in. Are they really going to attempt it? No, they're just moving around the top side. They're going to give this dragon up to 3-2-1. And I think this is a huge mistake.
I'm not sure. Well, they're trying to get something out of nothing. There's no way that they can test dragon right now. They don't have a team fight that matches up anywhere near to the team fight potential of 3-2-1. So they really just had to try and move up the top lane, maybe push a wave and pick up a second tier turret in the process. But it's really just weird. And Seraph has to use his teleport defensively. Like, very defensively.
Very quickly, too, as fast as TDK was moving up there.
Yeah, he had
to. 3-2-1, rather.
Yeah, he was just afraid that he would get caught out. There's a lot of mobility on this lineup. So he didn't want to give up a free kill in a situation where they had already given up a dragon.
Yeah, really, really strange and questionable decision-making from TDK right now. They seem a bit lost. 5,000 gold in the hole. They've not contested 3 dragons this game. It's really just looking a lot better for 3-2-1. They're in a great position to be able to push this in. But as you mentioned, later on in the game, they tend to be a little indecisive. We'll see if that does burn them. But for now, they are making all the right moves.
They are starting to ramp up a bit. LewisXGG has finished those Iceborne Gauntlets, which is a pretty big spike for him. Maybe not so much as far as damage goes, but like his poke potential, his kiting potential, his chase potential, all are increased exponentially with that Iceborne Gauntlets pickup. And it can really be hard, especially for a team like 3-2-1, who doesn't really have too much hard engaging. They have like a Kassadin and Aurelia and maybe a Crowstorm, which doesn't really lock anybody into place. Ezreal with the Iceborne Gauntlets can be a really tough tool that TDK possesses for 3-2-1 to deal with later on as this game progresses, just because it might be hard for them to stick on a target long enough for them to be able to clean up kills as the fight goes on and on. So
we have to be careful not to get just caught up by, as you mentioned, the stun train too. I mean, at this point, the indicator that the Iceborne Gauntlet gives is that TDK is going to rely very heavily on Conquan and Seraph to initiate, and Frozen Tomb or Tippers try to grab the enemy team as much as they possibly can. Really going to be difficult, though. It's kind of a very slippery 3-2-1 team.
Well, they have the tools to be able to turn this around, and they have to know that 3-2-1 is just not the best at closing out games, and this is what they do. 3-2-1, when in doubt, they head down mid lane, and they clear waves, and they just sit here.
Indecisive challenger guy.
Insert generic North American indecisive challenger player. That is exactly how 3-2-1 operates. And like the trend for them is, what they'll do is Azingi will farm his jungle. They'll group as 5, clear out one wave in mid, realize that they're not going to find an engagement, and then Big Ol' Ron heads up top, Jackstar heads down bottom, clear waves, rinse and repeat. That's what they do.
So far, so good working out for them right now, but TDK's been able to defend. And as you mentioned, it's kind of following a pretty formulaic start there, except for LewisXGG does take a rocket to the back of the head. 3-2-1, still in possession of a 3-dragon lead and trying to get some wards cleared out here as Big Ol' Ron makes his move back up to the top lane to clear out the wave.
Yeah, so TDK, while we have a little bit of downtime, is a really cool story. LewisXGG was formerly known as Loyal. He was actually a sub for the generic Greenwind Falcons in Korea, in OGN. Kyle, he's, of course, we talked about earlier, he was like a Jace-only streamer for a while from Korea, Korean Challenger player. And of course, Kena being Seraph. So what happened was LewisXGG was a part of the old TDK, but it sort of dissipated when they didn't qualify for the expansion tournament. Phoenix was their mid laner, and he got picked up by Curse. And Yuno was actually their support player, and she got picked up by Roar. And so Kyle sort of dropped everything to come to the U.S. to try out for Coast. And it didn't work out because of communication issues. His English isn't that great. But with Seraph being a free player now, and with Kez also being a Korean-American who speaks fluent Korean, and Conquan being a Korean-American who speaks fluent Korean, they made sort of this American-Korean hybrid that actually they use Korean on their voice comms to speak. So it's really cool that Seraph and Kyle and LewisXGG, who are Korean players trying to make it in North America, to find a team where they can speak Korean and not suffer from communication issues. So it's a really cool story there with a lot of these players, and it worked out well for them.
Yeah, it's so far doing pretty well. Been impressed with them in this tournament. This particular move they just made on the screen was actually very nice too. While they realized 3-2-1 were hanging out by Baron and not starting it, they utilized the True Shot Barrage to aggro it and actually kind of beat up 3-2-1 quite a bit, who weren't prepared for that. And they grab a turret in the middle too. Very, very good sense of map awareness. Now Seraph has to bail out. They're really afraid of Big Ol' Ron, and I would not be surprised if they try to avoid him most of this game.
So they're not bleeding out, which is the good thing here. They're finding opportunities where they can to take objectives. They're keeping the gold lead where it is. They're not making up any ground, but they're not losing any ground either. So the longer this game goes on, the less percentage of gold they'll be down overall. And once you get to the late game, it really doesn't matter how much of gold lead you had early, because people will be approaching full items, and all that will matter is your engagement, your teamfight power, and your positioning in teamfights. And TDK just has so many more tools at their disposal to initiate good fights with Cataclysm, with the Frozen Tomb, and with like Tibbers, then 3-2-1, who really doesn't have too many.
Yeah, they're going to try to find a fight here before the Dragon goes down. Arc second takes out Kez. The Dragon has started to reset. Azingi in full Crowstorm mode is going to force TDK to back off. Conquan's down. Wow, Arc second picking up the triple kill as he takes Kyle out as well. That did not go the way TDK wanted. And they're losing out more. A quadra kill for Arc second as he finds Louis GG around the backside. And only Seraph is going to survive.
And that was just pretty poor engagement by TDK. They tried to force it a little bit too hard. They were sort of a little bit disjointed. They didn't put together all of their initiation abilities. Kez died almost immediately. He didn't even have a chance to use the Cataclysm in the fight, which is actually a huge deal. Seraph was just way ahead of his team there. And when you're in that type of situation where you're behind in a game by that much and the enemy team is power spiking, unless you have an ideal engagement, you're not going to come out on top of fights. And 3-2-1 just capitalizes it on it, picks up their fourth dragon of the game, plus the Baron buff. So this is really early for this sort of powerful combination with four dragon buffs and the Baron buff to happen in a game. If you get that before 30 minutes, it makes it really, really tough for the enemy team to defend against pushes. So I don't know if TDK is going to be able to deal with this. Their wave clear is okay with Lulu, but that's about it. I guess Annie can help as well. The one thing that they can take away from that is that 3-2-1 doesn't have the greatest siege, but a Baron buff and four dragons.
Yeah, it's going to be hard for TDK to deal with, and if they end up giving up a fifth dragon as well, it's nearly impossible at that point. They've not been able to secure a single one for themselves, and that is the team that had such great control yesterday. It's really ridiculous how much 3-2-1 are schooling them, and again, going back to picks and bans, a lot of it ties in with that. They've given up so much to 3-2-1. And if they lose this one game, how much does that affect your mindset going forward? They've already won $2,000. They want to go further. A lot of the teams, as we mentioned, said they want to, you know, buy some better equipment, invest a little bit ahead of the North American Challenger Series. But they have to get ahead on this one. And here we go. 3-2-1 looking confident enough to start chasing down through the jungle. Kez is already at half health and has to go back to Fountain to heal it up. But 3-2-1 roving through the jungle to see if they can set themselves up a couple of picks.
TDK has not lost a game thus far in this tournament. Through the round of 16, the round of 8, we're now in the round of 4, and TDK just has not lost. So they haven't had to deal with yet, and they're a little bit of an untested team in tournament play. They haven't had to deal with losses yet. So we'll see how they do that as a team. These guys have a lot of experience under their belt. Most of these guys have played on stages before. Kez, Seraph, LouisXGG. They've all played competitively for a long time, so they have the experience, but will they be able to deal with it? Seraph was known as a player who tilted really easily on CLG. This is a different environment for him. I'm sure he's more comfortable with having a better communication ability, but we'll see how they deal with it, because this is looking really grim for them.
Yep, right now, big ol' Ron just wreaking havoc on all of TDK's members in the back line. Kez gonna try to make something happen here. Wild Growth to keep him alive for just a second, but Azingi targets him with a Terrify and picks him off. Conquan now taken out. Azingi in the front with the Crowstorm. They don't lose a single member. Even big ol' Ron survives with a blinking health bar, and they're shoving on Nexus turrets. It's only 31 and a half minutes in, but this game looks to be over. Kyle all the way back to his fountain, sticking around, but drained down by Azingi. Still have no defense here. One Nexus turret falls. The other should go pretty quickly. It is just 3-2-1's game, and has been from the very beginning. Bare Nexus right now, and there's no one to defend. That's game number one, and Team Dragon Knights will have a lot to think about.
Wow, that was a really impressive victory from 3-2-1.